Blessed is he that readeth and heareth the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. But you know, if God should stamp eternity or even judgment on our eyeballs, or if you like, on the fleshy table of our hearts, I'm quite convinced we'd be a very, very different tribe of people, God's people in the world today. We live too much in time, we're too earthbound. We see as other men see, we think as other men think. We invest our time as the world invests it, we invest our money. We're supposed to be a different breed of people. The day is coming in the which all who are in the grave shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they shall rise, all that are in the sea and all that are in the grave. And they're all going to stand at the judgment seat of Christ. What will he be like? I believe that the Church of Jesus Christ needs a new revelation of the majesty of God. This is what? This is the King of Kings, and he's the Judge of Judges, and it's the tribunal of tribunals, and there's no court of appeal after it. The verdict is final. Listen, when you see Jesus, you're not going up and say, "Hey, buddy, I'm glad you died for me." When you see Jesus, you'll be almost paralyzed with fear unless you had a glorified body and a glorified mind. I think sometimes we think we're going to march up and say, "Well, you know, Jesus, do you know how many years I served you, and how many souls I won for you, and how many sermons I preached for you?" Oh, no, 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 no. Well, what will he be like in heaven? Well, I'll tell you what the book says he'll be like. It says his hair is as white as snow. His feet are like burnished brass. His face is like the sun in its strength. His eyes are living coals of fire. His tongue is a sharp two-edged sword. And here is John, who used to lean his head on the bosom of Jesus and hear that divine heartbeat. The man that I believe knew more about Jesus than anyone else. And when he saw Jesus there on his throne in his majesty, with his face brighter than the sun, with his feet like burnished brass, with his eyes like flames of fire, with his tongue majestic and his voice like the sound of many waters, John, the man who had walked with him and talked with him for 3 years, says that when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. What do you think you and I are going to do? I want to tell you something. There'll be 1,000,000,000 or 1,000,000,000,000 people when you stand there at the judgment seat without your wife to lean on, or your husband, or your preacher, or a friend. And Paul is writing in the 14th chapter of Romans, and he says, we, so he writes home even to believers at the judgment seat. We must all, there's no exception. We must stand at the judgment seat of Christ. You can't send your lawyer, you can't send a representative. You can't send a preacher who says, "Well, I understand this person who's always falling up and down and in and out, and he didn't know where they were. I'll explain it to you." And the Lord says, "You won't do anything of the kind." It says the books were open. What books? Oh, there's going to be some weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Everything you've done, every idle word you've spoken, every action. I'm not really too worried about what I've done. It's the things I could have done that worry me. The things that I missed. We're not going to be judged just because of what we've done. We're going to be judged for why we did it. Not for the action, for the motive. What motivated your giving? So you'd have a plaque with your name on? Why? What's the motive behind it? I'd be fascinated when Pontius Pilate stands before Jesus. I think he'll feel less comfortable than Jesus felt standing before Pontius Pilate. They're all going to stand there. The secret archives of our hearts and lives are going to pass before. Oh, I don't think the redeemed will remember their sorrows and heartaches, but I'll tell you what, the unholy dead will remember every time somebody put a tract in their hand. They'll feel it through eternity and wish to God it was there. They remember that they heard their mother's prayers. They remember every sermon. They're going to remember everything. Memory is eternal. It will never die. You say, "Well, I came this morning, my wife wanted me to come, but I don't think I'll come again. I don't like this kind of stuff." Well, friend, let me tell you lovingly, go to hell and live with all the scum of the earth. You like to drink, go with the drinkers. You like to lust, go with the prostitutes. In hell, if you're given to lust after women, you'll have that lust, but there's nothing to satisfy your lust. If you drink, you'll thirst, but there's nothing to satisfy your thirst. You'll give a king's ransom for one drop of water. There isn't even a drop of water, never mind that precious wine you drink. When in God's name is the church going to open her heart again and open her mind again and see again that every man, I care not whether he flies his own private Learjet, or how many millions he has, or rules over a city, the great of the earth and the scum of the earth, and the unbelievers are going to spend their time in eternity. They're going to live there forever and ever. The good book says, "Where their worm dieth not." They said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who is able to stand? In those days shall men seek death and shall not find it. They shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. I believe there'll be a day when a man will put a gun to his head and blow his brains out, and to his amazement he'll still be living. He'll throw himself from the top of the Empire State Building or the top of a rock into the valley, he'll still be living. They shall seek death, but they shall not find it. There's no rainbow of mercy. Mercy is gone forever. A soldier said to me one day, can God forgive every sin I've ever committed? I said, he sure can. That is, if you repent of your sin and you plead for the blood of Christ and you ask for mercy. This morning, Jesus is on a throne of mercy. He shall find grace to help. But when we see him here, he's not on a throne of mercy. He's on a throne of justice. That tender Christ who went about doing good and he kissed little babies and blessed people. Now, there's nothing more beautiful than a little lamb. There's nothing more terrible than the wrath of the Lamb. And one day God's mercy is going to be cut off. And then it'll be the wrath of the Lamb. Do you think that Stalin ever dreamed that all the bloody purges he made, he'd have to answer for every precious drop of blood he ever spilled? And I think we better watch this business of, you know, God loves you, God loves you, and all the bumper sticker sloppy evangelism. Will you remind people of the goodness and the severity of God? Will you remind them that there's a day when mercy is cut off forever? Will you remind them that people pray in hell but nobody ever answers? The dead, small and great, are going to stand before God in that awesome day. Mercy is gone forever. The most shattering thought I've ever had is my personal accountability to God one day. This is the judgment of the believers now. If any man's work abide which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet as by fire. He says your life can be wood or hay or stubble, or your life can be silver, gold or precious stones. And the fire shall try every man's work. Remember, our God is a consuming fire. From the moment you began to witness for Christ, all your service, all your labors for him, they're going to be shown. Oh, now listen, none of the filthy world, none of the outcasts of hell are going to be there. Won't it be wonderful when you see all the redeemed of all the ages, when you look there and say, you know, there's Abraham. I didn't think he looked quite like that, but he's going to be there all right. And all the saints of all the ages are going to be there. Won't it be wonderful and say, see, those are the men who walked with Jesus. See, there's Paul. He gave his colossal intellect to God. He wrote about 14 epistles. He went over Asia Minor. He didn't sit in a jet and say, you know, how good the Lord is to me. No, sirree. He was lashed to the post 195 times. He was in weariness and fastings and painfulness and tribulation and distress and famine and peril and nakedness and sword. In tribulation amongst false brethren. In perils of the deep. You think that man's going to get 2 ounces of reward for a life like that? You'll only get rewarded. Grace is free, but rewards are not free. People say you're talking about works. Sure I am, because God did. Jesus did. I'd like to see a pocket full of those gorgeous people who prayed. These are the prayer warriors. These are the great sufferers. These are the travailers. These are the missionaries. There's going to be all kinds of people listed in that great day. It's going to be an awesome thing. A man's life, all his ministry. Do you see the difference between the wood and the hay and the stubble and the silver and the gold and the precious stones? Wood, hay and stubble are above the ground. They catch the eye. Silver and gold and precious stones are below the ground. Nobody sees them. There's a lot of public ministry in that day that's going to go down in ashes, my brother. You say, well, it doesn't say that the Christians are going to be judged out of the book. Yes, I think it does. In Malachi, it says that God has a book of remembrance. And I think it would do you good before you go to bed every night this week to ask God, what did you put in your book today from my life? Jesus talked about these men who go and take widows' houses. Well, that's what they're doing now. They're not satisfied that you give while you're living. They're asking you to hand your house over to them and leave this in your will. And if you do, you'll get a better place in heaven. Don't believe it for a moment. It's a lie from hell. They're going to give an account to God in that day. But I believe we're going to give an account too. Every penny you earn since you became the property of Jesus Christ, you give an account of before God. He doesn't just take your sins, he takes yourself. He takes the government of your life. And it's not only true that we live in a world of bankrupt politics, we live in a world, and this is the most tragic of all, of a bankrupt church. Your life is wood, the fire's going to come. Hay, the fire's going to come to it. Stubble, the fire's going to come to it. But what if your life is silver and gold and precious stones? Gold, I believe, there is a sign of our devotion to God. What happens when you burn gold? Nothing. All you do is change it from solid to liquid, but you don't reduce it. Can you see all the saints of all the ages? And Leonard Ravenhill is standing there before a Christ whose eyes are full of holiness, where the place is breathing holiness, where there's all the majesty of an awesome God. And he reads the record of my poor life before all the saints of all the ages. And he puts the fire to my devotional life. Am I just a good showman? I sure like to preach because God called me to preach. And I don't care how I preach, and I don't care whether you believe me either. I'm not responsible for that. I preach out of my heart all I believe, and I die for it. A statement Dr. Tozer made to me once, he said, Len, you know what? He said, we'll hardly get our feet out of time into eternity and gaze on eternity before we bow our heads in shame and humiliation and say, my God, look at all the riches there were in Jesus Christ, and I've come to the judgment seat almost a pauper. For God has not merely given us Jesus Christ, he's given us all things. And because there isn't enough joy in the house of God, we need entertainment. Because entertainment is the devil's substitute for joy. Because there isn't enough power in the house of God, people are always looking for the last scientific development, and their hair stands up when they see some fancy show on TV. I think before we point the finger at the world, we better turn to the church and say, look, we better all get sackcloth and ashes and humble ourselves and say, Almighty God, when I see the church in the New Testament, they didn't have stately buildings, they didn't have paid evangelists, they didn't have a lot of money, they didn't have organization, they couldn't get on TV and beg, but I'll tell you what they did, they turned the world upside down. And I'm embarrassed to be part of the Church of Jesus today because I believe it's an embarrassment to a holy God. Most of our joy is clapping our hands and having a good time, and then afterwards we're talking all the drivel of the world. You get so near to the heart of God that you share his grief over a world and over a backslidden church that we have today. Are you prepared to challenge demon power and say, listen, I've moved into the place where the Apostle Paul was when he said, I glory in tribulation, in necessities, in reproaches. Because if you're going to get mature in God, all the dwarfs around you will criticize and sneer at you. And say you're trying to be holier than the rest of us, huh? The only thing that will tie me in victory continually through the blood of Christ is my personal devotion to him, the Son of God. My adoration that I give him my tribute every day. It's more than my service. It's more than giving my money. That I love him and I adore him and I magnify him. I take him, as it were, by the feet. The one thing that's wrong with that world outside is it thinks it's done with Jesus Christ and it hasn't even started with him yet. The silver, what is the silver? The book of Proverbs says the tongue of the just is as choice silver. Yeah, every idle word you've spoken, even since you were saved, God has a kind of, you know, he doesn't need a tape recorder, but he has an eternal record of it. You know, the gossip, the slander, the criticism, the prejudice. You know, when somebody upset you and instead of being quiet, you spilled out just what was on your heart at that moment. Can you think of all those awesome words? Can you think of all the words we've preached to thousands of people over the years? And we're going to answer at the, and the fire is going to be put to them. The fire shall try every believer's work. Silver, gold, precious stone. What are the precious stones? Well, when I read that, I think of the breastplate that was on the priests. The priest in the Old Testament, it was divided into 12. Each stone was a different stone. Each stone had the name of a tribe on it. And he went into the holy place to pray with a breastplate on him. Do you know why the world is poor and sick outside? Because we really don't know how to pray, that's why. I've said it many times, I say it again this morning, that no man is greater than his prayer life. For the greatest ministry, I'm sure, is the ministry of intercession. And to some, God will say, come ye blessed, and others he'll have said, depart from me. I could remind you that there are at least five crowns to be given in reward. Paul says that the Lord will give him a crown of righteousness, which he says the Lord will not only give to me, but all them that love his appearing. There's a crown for the martyrs, those who will die today and have died other days. There's a crown to be given to them. There'll be great distinctions in heaven. You can't think that the dying thief, he'll be in heaven all right, because he said, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And sure enough, God will do that. Jesus said he would. But he'd wasted his life. We shall stand at the judgment seat of Christ. An awesome prospect for any of us. It's going to be an awesome day. Have you kind of figured how you'll get on when you stand there? Before all the saints of all the ages, and you and I are to stand there alone on a dais and be judged for the deeds done in the body, for every aspect of our lives, for our praying, for our giving, for our living, for our talking. No, it's not so simple to be a Christian after all. It's a majestic thing. And I don't care, there's no burden too heavy, there's no situation too hard for the one that you love. Because if there's anything about love, one thing about it, it's obedient. And if we get back to a people who are really baptized with obedience, submissive to the total will of God, not concerned about human opinion, not asking for more to spend prodigally on ourselves, but say, oh God, I want this life of mine adjusting so when I stand in your awesome presence, as James says, we shall not be ashamed at his appearing.